Hachette Audio presents Stories I Might Regret Telling You, written and read by Martha Wainwright. To my dad and his sister Teddy, born Martha Taylor Wainwright, 1947 to 2020. 1. I was born Martha Gabrielle Wainwright in New York State in 1976. My mother, Kate McGarrigle, and my father, Loudon Wainwright III, loved me, or at least they grew to love me. Loudon told me when I was a teenager that he didn't want me at first and pressured my mother to have an abortion. My mom freaked out just as the procedure was about to start, though, and the doctor spoke up. He was concerned for her, and he pointed out that Loudon and Kate were married, had some degree of financial stability, and had one child already, my brother, Rufus. Maybe not the best reasons to bring a child into the world, but I'm glad the doctor opened his mouth. I was surprised when Loudon told me this story, and it also hurt my feelings. I had always felt a little out of place in the world, and knowing that I'd only just barely made the cut didn't help matters any. Perhaps he should never have told me. I don't think my mom would have. When I asked her about it, she said that he had given her an ultimatum. Something like, the baby and me, or else the baby and the career, but not all three. I never understood why exactly. But perhaps Dad felt threatened by her remarkable talent and didn't like the attention she was getting from record labels at the time. My mother was beguiling and a force of nature, and maybe it was all too much for him. I suppose I could ask him about it again, but I don't want to. Kate is not around to hear his answer, and anything he says may be the truth as he sees it, but will not be the whole story. My parents separated anyway, only months after my birth, and my mother carried me and my brother back to her native Montreal. Decades later, I had to navigate a bad divorce myself and found that being able to explain or express in an exact way how things go wrong is impossible. Their marriage, like mine, was rocky, and now I understand better than when I was a teenager why I almost wasn't born. Montreal is where I grew up, but my brother and I would visit our father and his side of the family in New York 3 or 4 times a year and over the summer holidays. We would travel on Eastern Airlines with our names hung around our necks, chaperoned by what was still referred to as a stewardess. Other times, Kate drove us down along the Taconic State Parkway. We spent some of those summer visits on Shelter Island at the eastern tip of Long Island. I always felt like an island myself, and Rufus and I spoke French to each other sometimes so as to not be understood by our father. I have spent my life traveling between these two cities, New York and Montreal, and have never felt fully at home in either, which has suited me fine because I was taught to be an outsider. An outsider with a ferociously close family. For better or worse, music is the family business. My mother and her sister performed as the duo Kate and Anna McGarrigle. My father is a witty, morbid songwriter. Rufus is one of the most famous singers in the world, at least in my mind, and his. My half-sister, Lucy Wainwright Roach, and one of my father's sisters, Sloane, are singers too. My cousin Lily Lankin, Anna's daughter, has sung with me for years, but she won't commit full-time to music because she knows what the performing life can do to someone. She and her brother Sylvan have designed and stuffed my CDs, driven me to gigs, and helped my career in other ways since the beginning. My ex-husband, Brad Albetta, played bass for me, as well as for the rest of the family. My Aunt Teddy, Dad's sister, managed most of us at one point or another. And for 20 years, my other aunt, Jane, managed her sisters, Kate and Anna. On my father's side, we are related to the Stuyvesants, early settlers of New York. So in my veins runs a diminished, waspy tint of blue blood that has been diluted with Irish and French-Canadian red. My mother and her sisters were brought up Catholic. I was never baptized, although I went to a French school and was taught by nuns who told me that I was going to burn in hell with all the other sinners. Rufus loves the waspy side of the family with its ties to old money, or maybe he just loves money. He has admitted to having a spending problem. But he also loves his Catholic side. His apartment is filled with Virgin Marys, and he's always running around the world lighting candles in cathedrals. I don't know if anyone is listening to his prayers, but it seems as though someone could be. I myself admit to having lit a few candles in the last 10 or so years of childbirth, death, and divorce. Clearly, the results have been mixed. I don't know what I believe, and that's been a problem my whole life. Growing up, my maternal grandmother, Gabrielle, known as Gabby, was my greatest hero. She was old even when I was a baby, having been born herself in 1904. Her husband, Frank, was born in 1899. It seemed like a parlor trick to have a grandparent from the 1800s. Gabby was the eldest daughter of a large French-Canadian family. Her mother gave birth to 17 children, and 12 survived. A woman having so many pregnancies always seemed like another parlor trick to me, too, an implausible leftover from a much earlier time. Gabby was a big part of my upbringing. On weekends and holidays, my mother took us to stay with her in Saint-Sauveur-des-Monts, a small skiing village north of Montreal. When she toured, Gabby took care of us. My grandfather, Frank McGarrigle, had bought an acre of land in the village and, with the help of an architect friend, built the family home and eventually added 4 small cabins. After he died in 1965, Gabby stayed on in the house we call Saint-Sauveur, Saint Savior in English. Everyone in my family still counts on the place to welcome us and comfort us and smooth us over whenever we're feeling down. Today, the house is sinking into the ground. Perhaps my grandfather could have used an engineer, not an architect. Most of us have been too busy to deal with it. But recently, my cousins did a beautiful thing, rebuilding the living room exactly to the original design and securing at least that part of the house. To me, Saint-Sauveur is a living thing, almost like a grandmother's lap, a comfortable place you know won't be around forever, so you want to enjoy it while you can. My mother and her sisters grew up there, and Gabby lived there for 60-odd years, over half of them without her husband. I loved the story she told me of 1920s and 30s Montreal. She worked for Marconi as a telephone operator and also as a secretary for the Bronfman family, who were big bootleggers during Prohibition and later built a business empire on the proceeds. As the eldest of so many brothers and sisters, she never wanted to get married and have children of her own. She often told the story of how, as a teenager, she would sit at the top of the stairs reading her book, and as different siblings ascended the stairs to come play or fetch something, she would systematically kick them back down. Of course, she did have children, or I wouldn't be writing this, but not until her late 30s. My mother, Kate, was her last, born in 1946, when Gabby was 42. As a grandmother, Gabby wasn't sweet or mean, but sometimes she could be both. She had a hunched back, the curve caused by never wearing the special shoe that was supposed to compensate for the fact that one of her legs was shorter than the other. But even with that hunch, she was handsome and strong, and she lived to the age of 91, longer than most of her siblings. She didn't get stuck in her ways, but changed with the times. She went from wearing bloomers as a teenager to a t-shirt of my brother's that said, "Fuck school, fuck work, fuck the president," in her 80s. She let time have its way with her body, too. Once she left her false teeth on a table and my dog stole them and buried them in the lawn somewhere. Back to the earth. The intimacy she shared with me made me feel good. I liked to watch her wash in the bathroom sink, and I would often apply moisturizer to the scaly skin on her legs and arms, or muscle cream to her misshapen back. We often slept in the same room and sometimes in the same bed, sharing candies she stashed under it in a plastic bag. I mixed her many gin and tonics, and after I turned 13, she let me smoke with her from time to time. Neither one of us inhaled. I was 16 when she died, and I felt her presence rise in me so strongly it seemed as if I could take on some of her traits, strength, wit, resilience. But I didn't have her confidence, so I couldn't really pull it off. I simply had to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.